Plugged Inland represents KVCR's continuing interest in focusing on important issues in the inland area. Supported by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, we're looking into innovations and solutions in education as part of the American Graduate. Let's make it happen. And you can help us make it happen. Call us anytime during the show at 866-367-5827. Or you can send questions or comments right from our website at pluggedinland.org. Or you can email us questions and comments to questions@pluggedinland.org. And you can tweet us at @KVCR.
Welcome to Plugged Inland. I'm Roger Bowman. Teenagers who drop out of high school, or who are on the verge of doing so, often feel isolated and ignored. But a new method of helping them has proven successful, not only at getting them back into high school, but also preparing them for and enrolling them in college courses. In a moment, we'll talk with Jill Marks, the director of an innovative program of intense mentoring that turns high school dropouts and at-risk students into successful college attendees. Join us as we explore how Riverside City College came to be a national pilot school for a program being adopted throughout the U.S.
My name is Andrea Leanna Gill.
My name is Alan Charlton.
My name is Victor Romo.
I'm 17 and I'm a junior in high school.
I'm 18 and I am a senior in high school.
I'm 18 years of age and I go to school at RCC. I'm a freshman.
I'm Brenda Forsey and I'm a student resource specialist with Gateway to College here at Riverside.
I recently got kicked out of high school and I came to this program.
It's usually for people who have lost their path, and it's a program to try to get you caught up and get you into college.
And combined with Road Trip Nation, it's like, now that you have the skills to be successful in college, Road Trip Nation makes sure that you're successful after college.
They actually are face to face with somebody from their local community. It makes it real that, you know, all different types of people are successful and happy, and you don't have to live in this far, far away land or be from this particular group of people. It's here in our community.
I interviewed Billy Stevens. He's the CEO of Dinky Music. He used to be a rock star. He actually toured in his band America and Europe several times.
You learn the basics, you get your foot in the door, and you just
and then you
start.
Learn.
You just go.
Yeah. Work with whoever you can, stay as late as you can, learn everything you can.
As for a career choice, I want to get into audio engineering, becoming a mastering engineer.
I interviewed Deborah Postel, a district attorney, and I also interviewed Zulma Sanchez, a paralegal. I interviewed them because they're Mexican, and I'm like, they're in law, so I'm like, I'm Mexican and I want to get into law.
Our next door neighbor, his name is JB Grover, and he's the director for Autism on the Seas. So he takes care of everything. I didn't choose him at first. I actually went through like a couple more people, and it was so hard. Especially if you want like famous people. I did talk to publicists, but it was such a long process. And I was like, what about him? To me, he's like the most successful person. His son was autistic. He's 23 and he became my best friend. And I was like, what's Autism on the Seas? And they told me about it. And since I had a sister that was special, they were like, you can do it. That became my passion. Working with that type of kids, it gives you another point of view in life.
I would never have done this as a career choice. It never crossed my mind. But working with special needs families and kids is absolutely the best thing I ever did. And I'm thankful now that I was open enough to look at it when I did. So take that chance. Don't be closed-minded when it comes to career opportunities.
I absolutely believe Road Trip Nation has taught them about resiliency. They see firsthand, they get to speak with people who have had all kinds of obstacles, and they're now on on the other end of that tunnel. They talk with people who have experienced all kinds of hardships.
My dad left a long time ago, and so I was raised by my mom, and so. My mom raised me and my sister, and it was really hard for her because, I had a special sister that needed 10 times more attention than I did. And then I felt like I didn't get enough attention, so it was kind of a struggle. And then I got older, and then she became disabled, so she can't move around as much. So I became like the head of the household, and I had to take responsibility at like 15, you know, of everything.
It really does connect the pieces between formal education and being able to do what you love. So what they're doing here in their classroom, you know, at the college campus, is discovering the pieces that are missing and what they want to do.
I was like, okay, so what else can I do to help kids, you know? I was like, what if I become like a nurse and work with like kids in a children's hospital? I was like, I can do that because that's what I want to do, you know?
To know that, you know, the people that they see as successful and people they see on TV or people that are role models to them, at one point were in the same starting shoes as they were.
It's kind of inspiring to see the kind of people who went against all odds and went and did something that they actually wanted to do and are successful.
And they helped me understand that our race doesn't matter as long as we be someone. And like, there's someone now, and if there's someone, I know I can be someone too.
I gained more motivation because of how he told me, like, just be happy with what you do. And like, seeing how he is right now, and he's not the most successful person, like money-wise, you know what I'm saying? But he's happy, and that's all I want, you know?
We had 100% of the students complete the projects, which is, I mean, that's huge. To have 100% of students do an assignment is, I don't have any other assignment where I have 100% of students completing it.
You know, you see the inspirational videos and you're like, oh, that's cool, you know, like those people did it. But once you hear it in person with somebody who's standing right in front of you and who made it and they were raised in the same situation you were, it hits closer to home. And it really enables you to like take what this program is saying and actually believe it and apply it.
Gateway and the Road Trip together, I think they have gave me more of a plan, like a set plan. I knew what I wanted to do and I knew what it was gonna take to get there, but now I have more of a road. So I think kind of like put my pavement down, you know, and just paved it for me.
I came to realize that I can follow my dream if I just put myself out there and like get out of my comfort zone and like shed my shyness and like get out there and just meet people. Because meeting someone could lead me to someone else. That leads me to someone else is gonna get me a job or something.
If you open your mind up and you actually listen to the videos and you follow the lessons, you can actually learn something, whether it's about career exploration or just finding yourself as a person and learning like who you are and where you fit in and everything.
If you come in with an open mind and be like, this is gonna be really cool, you know, you're gonna learn so much and you're gonna grow as a person, you know, not just as, you know, like a student, but as a person.
Supports the academic, social, and emotional needs of students. Fosters the development of knowledge and skills. Serves the whole student. Partners with available community resources. Creates and fosters community among students.
Joining me in studio is Jill Marks, Program Director for RCC's Gateway to College program. Also joining is Brittany Lopez, a student of the Gateway to College High School. Thank you both for being here. Brittany, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Jill, I want to talk a little bit about, we mentioned Gateway to College and RCC, and we also mentioned this Gateway to College High School. Mm-hmm. Can you distinguish them for me?
Sure, Roger. In 2004, the school district, Riverside Unified, and the community college, which was Riverside Community College, now it's Riverside City College, collaborated and saw a very powerful program at Portland Community College called Gateway to College. At that time, Portland Community College was given a grant to replicate, so the two entities entered into a formal partnership, applied for grant funding, which was at that time provided by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to start up, and thus a charter school was born, Riverside's Gateway to College Early College High School, that rolled out this Gateway to College program.
So what you're telling me is this started in Portland, Oregon, mm-hmm. at a college, mm-hmm. and they started a program that helped kids go to college that were struggling in high school.
That was the genesis of the program. It was at Portland Community College, and they came to the attention a couple of years later to Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which at that time was putting together the Early College High School Initiative. And indeed, Gateway to College became one of the partners in the initiative, one of the early college high school models that was funded and is now being replicated across the nation. There are 35 sites.
We hear so much about the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Mm-hmm. They seem to be investing in every innovative program out there. And I have to say, this one surprised me. It's one of, I think, the more innovative that I've seen. So I'm glad they're involved mm-hmm. because not only do they bring dollars, but they seem to bring attention and credibility. And you mentioned Portland wanted to replicate. Replicate means other people are going to do the same thing, and Riverside was one of them.
What we've noticed too is we were trained and really aligned with the Portland model, but as replication occurs, we did this as a charter school. We needed to do this in California because of the particular regulatory environment. And we've learned a lot about Gateway to College as the model has been replicated in 20 other states. There's different regulatory environments, there's different requirements, there's different practices that Gateway to Colleges need to add or to address. So we've learned a lot about different kinds of ways to tweak and innovate Gateway to College throughout the years since 2004. Which have really launched the replication project.
It's a fairly new program then. We're talking 2004
yes.
to now, a short duration in terms of education mm-hmm. innovation. Just so that our audience understands, what we're talking about is a high school that is on a college campus.
Yes.
And students go to the college to go to high school. And that seems to me the direct opposite of most of the high school programs that get you college credits, differentiated, say, mm-hmm. from AP courses.
Well, this is what we call intersegmental education, where we compress the last couple of years of high school, and students can earn up to 2 years of college units. Usually, these kinds of options are for students who are on track or fast tracking, but the Gateway to College model was very unique because it took the same ideas but thought students who are really not successful in the comprehensive high school or alternative schools, they have skills, they have abilities, but they never had this kind of opportunity before. And part of what students might need is a change of location where they're around young adults and older adults that are engaged in significant work. They're focused on their education, there's career technical education programs, there's college transfer, so the focus is different than the social and academic offerings in high school. And many students these days need a change of environment. They need to be away from the same peer groups.
I'm going to jump over to you,
okay.
Brittany. Yeah. Thank you for being here. You're a student
yes.
of the Gateway to College program at RCC.
Yes.
So that means that you started as a struggling student in high school. And I think most of us would, before tonight, think that somebody that's struggling in high school could never succeed at the college level. And you're one of the students that have shown us, nope, we have it all wrong. Tell me your story. Why were you struggling in high school?
Well, in high school, I felt like I was invisible. Like, none of the teachers really stood there and told you, you have to do this or you're not going to pass. They're just like, here's the work, do it or not, basically. And that just didn't motivate me. And I just didn't want to go to school. I wanted to do other things in
you're
school.
You're kidding. Like what?
Like, I just wanted to hang out with my friends and be outside of school, like have fun, go to the mall, movies, things that teenagers like to do.
Yeah, my son would play video games 24/7 if we didn't force him into school. But your parents got you to go to school, at least to attend.
Yeah, they're just like, you have to go to school or get a job. And I was like, I don't want to get a job. I guess I'll go to school. And school was just not interesting. I just went just to go, but not to learn. And then coming to my 12th grade year, I was told I wasn't going to graduate by my counselor, and she gave me this program. She basically told me, like, oh, this is a program.
I'm going to stop you for just a moment. You're told that you're not going to graduate. Was that a surprise, or was that expected?
A little of both, because some teachers passed me that I didn't do so much work, and then others didn't pass me. So I was just like, ugh.
You're saying some of the teachers would pass you for doing basically very little work.
Yeah, so, basic work, basically.
So it sounds like you thought maybe you'll squeak by and get out of graduate high school without having put in that extra effort.
Yeah, that's what I don't know, that's what I thought.
So is that what you do at Gateway to College? You don't put in the effort?
Oh, no. It's totally opposite. Well, my counselor told me that I wasn't going to pass, and she gave me a packet about Gateway to College. I looked through it. She told me this is one of the options I could do, so that was the first one, and that was the choice that I thought was good for myself. I went to the orientation. I enjoyed it, and then I went back for a test. I passed the test, and then I went to an interview with was my English teacher and then my old resource specialist, and they both interviewed me, and I was a little intimidated. I was like, oh, this is so weird, this is different. And then after that, I was accepted, and I started in the prep program first. It's prep and then foundation. It depends where they place you. And I was in prep, and then I went through that and then got to foundation, and then I started taking college courses.
But Brittany, you're the same person. You were the unmotivated attendee who was in the seat in a high school class, but not really checked in, not really engaged. And now you're in a college course, presumably much more intense, and you're succeeding.
Yes, I am. Why I think I'm succeeding and other students that are in Gateway is because all the support that Gateway has with the faculty and with the students. They don't make you show up. Teachers, they're pretty hard on you. They want you to have your work done. They tell you, like, this is it. This is going to make you or break you right here. They let you know, like, if you don't do the work, you're done. They're like bosses. But
and that's good for you.
Yes, but they're like family, too. They're like, they support you. They want the best for you. They just want to see you succeed.
And Jill, she mentioned the support that's there. Mm-hmm. And this program has been called a wraparound support mm-hmm. program. What does that mean?
I think we provide different kinds of support. For the most part, our students are first-generation college-going, so they need academic guidance. But students need day-to-day support, too. Sometimes there's nobody there to really listen to their issues. Sometimes they're issues of crisis. Sometimes they're issues of long-standing. But sometimes you just really, a student needs to really unload to a staff member. And what our staff has been trained to do, and what most of the Gateway to College National Network members do, is we really turn it back on the students and spend time with them to have them think about solutions to their own problems. We might be able to say, there are these resources that we have here at our charter school. We have these resources in our RCC department, at RCC, or out in the community. And we help connect students to utilize the resources and to really become self-advocates. But I think at the end of the day, sometimes if there's just something that's not working well for you, or you have questions about, or you don't understand the homework, our staff is small enough, flexible enough, and we have low enough, we have a low staff to student ratio where staff can sit down and have that conversation with a student. So a student feels that they're not invisible, that they are able to get what they need so they can go home and move forward that day.
Brittany, tell me a little bit about what was it like amongst your peers when you were in the high school environment? What was their focus? And differentiate that for me, if you would, with the Gateway to College program at RCC.
Well, when I was in high school, most of the people that I hung out with are just thinking, oh, what are we doing this weekend? What's new? What are rumors? And just basic teenage things. And then in the college environment with Gateway to College, they're like, they ask you, like, so what are academical goals? What do you want to do in life? And everyone wants to do something in life there. They want to go somewhere, and people just really start sitting down and thinking about, like, this is my time. What should I do? What do I really want to do? And everyone just helps each other through that. And that's what I thought was different about it.
So are you labeled a nerd for turning in your work at Gateway?
No. I think it's kind of weird if you don't turn in your work in Gateway, because everyone's just like, why didn't you do that? Like, don't you want to be here? Like, this is different. This is college. This isn't high school. You could just go by like and not turn in your work. You have to turn in your work to be there. You actually want to be there.
Jill, you talked about something that's kind of different than what we've talked about in past episodes of Plugged Inland, and that is the fact that the high school environment might not be right for everybody, mm-hmm. but it doesn't necessarily mean that they face challenges at home necessarily. That may be the case, of mm-hmm. course, but it isn't a necessity for them to not do well in school. And as you mentioned to me, the students are competent. So what is the difference, say, between the high school environment from your perspective as an administrator and the Gateway to College program?
I think wanting to be a Gateway is a volitional act. It's not compulsory, and most of our students are about to turn majority age if they're not there already, so they're choosing
Meaning they're
to be
18.
With us. Yes, and they're choosing to be with us. And what we offer is a scholarship, and for the first time too, it's very flattering to be offered a scholarship. And we feel that our students, through their application, through meeting with them, through finding out where their skill levels are, that they've earned this scholarship. And they begin to see themselves, this is a valuable thing, and they begin to see value in themselves. So I think that's one of the big differences in the program. Students have earned their way in. They've also they've gone through a reflection process too, where they're not really satisfied with their lives. They're not satisfied, they're not proud of themselves. And what we read in a lot of the essays and comes out in the interviews is they want their family to be proud. They want their brothers and sisters to feel good about them. They want to be role models for their friends.
Is that what prepares them to do the extra work that's entailed at the college level? Because mm-hmm. they weren't doing the work before in many mm-hmm. cases. And clearly, when they get into Gateway, your success rate would state that they're willing to do the work.
I think we have collective responsibility in Gateway to College, and what we have when students enter the program, and which we continue throughout all stages of the program until students graduate, is learning community. And it's really about groupedness and students supporting one another in a learning environment where they're all shooting for the same thing, that school is cool, and that the expectations are really, really high, and we help each other out here. So students have had to leave behind their peers who haven't had that attitude, and they find each other, and they're all shooting for the same thing. So I think having that peer environment, that learning community, is absolutely essential to support students as the work gets tougher, as the demands grow, as they form study groups to be able to work through the charter school and then the community college coursework.
We invited our audience to call and email so that they can ask questions or give us comments, mm-hmm. and they are already taking us up on that, and we appreciate that. So first, let me go to a call from Signe from Moreno Valley for Brittany. What's your comment? Signe, are you there?
Yes.
What's your comment?
I wanted to ask Brittany if being in the program made her realize what she wanted to do in life.
Good question. We talked a little bit about that, about your motivation. In what way did getting into Gateway help you understand that you had to look at the larger picture of your ongoing life, that it wasn't yes. just what you're going to do this weekend and what the rumors are?
Well, first, when I found out what I really wanted to do in life was when I was in high school taking an ROP class, I took a teacher named Mr. Solis, and he taught law enforcement. And he was just so passionate about what he did, and that made me, like, really grow into law enforcement. And after that, I was like, well, I need to think of, like, how can I get there? And through Gateway, through college, I talked to my resource specialist, and they're just telling me different ways, like what I could do, what fields I could go in, and from there, that's...
So, Brittany, you're saying that at the high school level, you took a law enforcement class, a vocational class,
yes.
and loved it, and went.
Yes, that's
and did all the work.
That's the only class I really went to and really, really enjoyed and wanted to be there.
So this really does come down to, and Jill, I'm going to ask you, mm-hmm. this is a program that not only supports students, but it motivates them by helping them link their academic studies to their future career.
I think it's key to find out, it's key to discover who you want to be. And in our program, I think that's a key component. We have a lot of focus on that. We begin when students enter the program. We have massive career exploration. You saw the Road Trip Nation curriculum and piece that we wind in with the RCC guidance career exploration course. And I think it's the motivation to keep going down a pathway that sometimes can be rigorous. Why am I here? And it keeps you, you have to build momentum. I think most of us who completed high school and went to college and maybe went to graduate school, we had an idea in mind, or we really bought into the idea of education. We'll be an educated person, then we'll kind of figure it out later. But I think what Gateway to College offers is some very concrete ways to find out who am I and who I want to be.
Brittany, you're popular. There's already an email. Another question for you. This is from Edward. What made Brittany interested in going to the Gateway College program when she wasn't interested to begin with? What made you motivated to succeed in the college program? Thank you, Edward.
Well, basically because my parents wanted me to succeed, and I wanted to succeed too because I didn't want to disappoint them. And from there, after I spoke with my counselor, that was the first packet she gave me, like, this is what you could do. I looked through it with my parents, and that, like, I was just like, okay, this will be something I guess I will try. I went with my dad to the orientation, and he enjoyed it, I enjoyed it. And then from there, my sister, I told her about it. I was like, go. And she enrolled too, and so did one of my friends. And then from there, that's just what motivated me to really go.
Yeah. Not only from the staff, but from colleagues, families, and friends.
Yes.
That's a great story. So let's take one more email, and this email is from Lydia. How are students selected for the program, and are the days similar to a typical high school day? I'm going to have you cut this short. We might pick it up again later, but go ahead.
How are students selected? Students can apply. We're online. They call us. We do an application process. They come to an orientation so they know what our expectations are and to make sure that they're eligible. Students do need to read at least at an eighth grade level because they're going to be shooting into college classes in a term. If they don't read at an eighth grade level, we will look at some, we will counsel students to see how they can build the skills to reapply. What does the typical schedule look like? It's not a typical high school schedule, it's a block schedule. Some high schools do block schedule, but we try and offer our classes much like college classes are patterned.
Great. So I want to ask more about the program and its funding, but Brittany, let me have you finally tell me, where are you in the program now?
Well, this is my first term that I'm taking actual college classes up in the campus, and so far, so good. I have about 5 more classes to take till I graduate, and
now, when you say graduate, that's graduate high school.
Yes,
but and then after that, you'll actually be in the RCC college program, or do you have to reapply? You're taking college classes now in conjunction with your high school. So once you finish up with your high school and you have college credits, will you automatically be a student at RCC to continue on with college?
I'll have to reapply for that.
Actually, but it's pretty likely you'll get in, I'm imagining.
Yes.
Our students actually do the application when they get in, so they are dually enrolled. They'll just change their status to high school graduate and they'll continue. So they are college students from the first day.
Got it. So thank you very much, Brittany. We loved having you here. Thank you for sharing the story. You know, one of the challenges most high school students have is a lack of awareness as to what career path they have and what is even out there available beyond doctor and lawyer. We saw in the earlier video a mention of a PBS show called Road Trip Nation, in which young adults travel the country in an RV to interview people with interesting jobs. Let's take a look at that program.
To bring an empowering experience to young people everywhere, Road Trip Nation has created an innovative curriculum that helps students connect what they study to the real world by creating their own road trip projects. Here's a look into how the Road Trip Nation experience inspires students to define their own roads in life.
I'm Andrew Galarza, I'm 16. I was born in the Bronx, I'm a Bronx boy. I'm a senior in high school, and I have no idea what's after this. It's just all a big blah to me.
Andrew is just one of about 18 million teenagers in the US that are enrolled in high school right now. Roughly 6 million of those students are not going to graduate. A major reason why so many students drop out is that they can't connect what they're learning to the real world. And a lot of times, the ones that do make it to graduation still have no idea what they want to do with their life. It's hard for students like Andrew to feel hopeful about their futures when they're struggling to see how school can help them create a life around what they love. It seems like a lot of people are talking about how to fix education right now. Here's what we're doing. This is the Road Trip Nation Experience Curriculum, which empowers students to define their own roads in life. For 10 years now, we've been sending young people on road trips across the country in search of wisdom and advice from leaders of all walks of life. Over these years, we've collected a massive archive of stories from all different kinds of people who have built lives following their individual interests and passions.
Where's your joy at? What really brings you joy? And I think a lot of times you go to college and you're not searching for your joy, or you're not told that. Search for a job, search for a career. But you can get all that if you're on the right path.
The Road Trip Nation Experience Curriculum makes it easy for any teacher to bring all this content into their classroom. It's a three-part curriculum consisting of 12 lessons and a self-guided road trip project. And it combines interactive online instruction with a student journal to give each student exposure to the themes and lessons we've gathered from the road, as well as resources to explore and clue into what each of their individual interests are.
It was all about them. Even the questions that they were responding to were reflective questions about things that they enjoy, things that they're nervous about, things they care about.
It's kind of like discovering who you are and who you truly are.
It really helps me find myself, that's what I really want to do, just find myself as a person.
The experience culminates with students going out into their local communities and interviewing their own leaders about how they got to where they are today.
We're gonna interview the fire chief.
A fashion designer.
We're actually gonna be interviewing Dr. Ruiz. He's a three-time Harvard graduate. First Latino to accomplish that.
Monday, I have to wake up at least at 5 a.m., which is awesome. Then hop in a cab over to NBC Studios and just basically meeting leaders and seeing how they got there.
When I heard about Road Trip Nation, I thought it was the most awesome idea. You get to interview people, put it on tape, and then put it on the internet. Others get to see it, and hopefully it'll help them figure out what they want to do.
I love the fact that it makes you question, because I think people don't really question things anymore.
You're actually asking the questions that you want to ask them, and you want to get the feedback on how you could be a better person.
What exactly gave you like the spark, like to start you out to want to be a firefighter in the very beginning?
When you were younger, say about our age, could you see yourself ever doing this career?
How did you overcome the obstacles that life thrown at you?
Where were you at our age? Where were you when you were 16, 17, and 18?
Did anyone doubt you in your process of trying to become a basketball player, trying to become Secretary of Education?
Oh, sure. You have people doubt you all the time. And so the question is, do you let those doubts stop you, or do you listen to them and take those weaknesses and turn them into strengths?
We all need to challenge ourselves often in order to help us grow as individuals.
You are so many steps ahead of where I was.
Really?
Honestly.
I felt like I was talking to her person to person. Like, so cool interviewing her.
Thank you.
Oh my God, thank you. She helped me out a lot.
Man, the me before, I could give you a long list of what was wrong with him. He wasn't confident in himself. He was always pessimistic. He always had fears looming over his head. And basically, he was scared to live. Then Road Trip Nation happened, and I like this new me. This new me is way more confident in himself. I interviewed an NBA player. I interviewed the president of NBC News. And I didn't interview them as their job. No, I didn't interview an occupation. I interviewed a person just to see what their fears were 10 years ago. Do they still have fears? Do they still worry about anything in their lives? What's their successes? What's their failures? I mean, just conducting the interviews was so eye-opening and making me realize there's so many things that I can be, and I have so many choices. I have so many choices of things that can make me happy.
Gateway to College relies in part on Road Trip Nation's ability to help high schoolers plan for a real career. Before I talk more about the aspects of goals on student motivation, I'd like to introduce a new guest joining us, Saul Baron. Saul is a graduate of the Gateway to College program. Thank you, Saul. Oh, I appreciate you being here.
Thank you, guys.
So you've graduated already, and what are you doing now?
Oh, I'm majoring in mechanical engineering.
At RCC?
Yeah.
So that rollover system worked perfectly in your case.
Oh, yeah, definitely. They really prepared me for the classes that I had to take for, you know, for my major.
And you're taking engineering?
Well, I'm taking the, you know, prerequisites so I can transfer into, you know, 4 years, so I can really solidify that.
Did you learn basically how to pass those college courses through the Gateway program?
It really helped me learn how to, you know, what was my flow to study, you know, how to really prepare for exams and to really handle that, you know, that amount of work.
You brought with you something that I'm going to show the audience in a moment. Uh-huh. Tell me about the notebooks that
okay.
you fill out.
Well, on top of them being more expensive than the typical, you know, spiral notebooks, They're just, I take pride in just the way that I write, my writing style. And I don't really like so much lectures. I kind of lecture myself with, you know, the textbooks and asking questions only when I really, really, really need to. I feel like if I were to discover the answers and figure out methods of, you know, just coming to the conclusions, mm-hmm. it just makes it so much more enjoyable and I retain the information better. I feel like I discovered it.
I appreciate that. It's a more challenging environment where
yeah.
you have to contribute some of your own work. You don't just listen
and just reiterate.
It's rote learning,
yeah.
right. I have to say, one of the reasons I appreciate your bringing the notebook
uh-huh.
is I'm envious.
Uh-huh.
I've taken calligraphy classes and I can't write this well.
Oh.
This is not the notebook I would expect to see from a struggling high school student.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you get into the Gateway? Why were you a struggling student?
Oh, well, it started back in high school. I did a lot of competitive sports, a lot of competitive combat sports, middle school through high school, the first year in high school. And that kind of, I ended up in the hospital due to some cardiovascular problems. And I fell behind in school for like about a year. I was inpatient for 8 months. So schooling was really hard, wires coming out of you and everything. Coming out, I was able to do independent study and basically be my own teacher for a while. And there, the teacher that I would have to see every week to take exams with gave me this application and said, "You're doing pretty well. You're doing excellent. I don't even know why you're coming to see me. Check out this application to Gateway. Maybe it'll challenge you more, prepare you for when you're done with high school, and help you out with your career."
So through a health issue, you really fell out of the typical high school curriculum.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I feel like I possibly would have struggled, even though I was only a freshman. It was a lot. There was a lot going on, a lot of things that were not very academic, you know, a lot of gossip, a lot of learning. You know, I feel like I would have struggled anyway.
I understand. You know, I'd like to go to an email, but first, Jill, I'm going to ask you. You've mentioned alternative education and whether or not the regular high school curriculum works for Sal and works for Brittany. And you yourself came through an alternative education program. Tell me about that.
I did. I didn't feel, I think much like Sal, I didn't feel really comfortable by the time I was in middle school on a large comprehensive school campus. I was bored. I wasn't doing my best work. My parents were both educators, and they had the flexibility to let me try something new and different at that time. That was a school within a school concept, and there were some things about it that were beneficial and some things that didn't really fit for me. But what I did really respond to was a small school environment of no more than 200 students. I could see what a tight collaborative staff could offer students who really needed to do it differently. So that never left me. I think it was in the back of my brain since high school. And here we come full circle, being able to roll out such a program, much different, but again, something where there's a relationship-driven school for youth.
We have an email from Bree. Road Trip Nation sounds like a wonderful program. Are the students selected from the Inland Empire to go? Very good question. Are they only from the IE?
Well, Road Trip Nation is a national, if we're talking about two things. One is the TV show, which is really college students doing that, but Road Trip Nation is a curriculum that was developed, and it's national. It's from there's a middle school curriculum, there's a high school curriculum, there's a college level curriculum. So in terms of who gets to road trip, that's up to the Road Trip Nation folks. But in terms of who can take the journey, who can be part of the curriculum, it depends on which schools, which school districts adopt, and at what level.
So let's talk for a moment about the difference between Road Trip Nation and your program, Gateway to College. They intersect a little bit. Road Trip Nation, as I understand it, mm-hmm. is the national program that helps kids visualize how they can get into a career that interests them in their life by interviewing people that are already there.
That's correct. The roadtripnation.org, I think, is the website, but they are a 501c3. They're a public benefit corporation that came out of the young men and the one woman who took the original road trip. They saw a benefit to provide that to youth in schools trying to find their way. So,
where'd they come from? What city?
I think I can't recollect. I want to say that they're Southern California. There certainly are Southern California folks now because their headquarters is in Newport.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Let's tell our viewers how you can ask your questions of our guests, either Saul the student or Jill the administrator.
Plugged Inland represents KVCR's continuing interest in focusing on important issues in the inland area. Supported by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, we're looking into innovations and solutions in education as part of the American Graduate Let's Make It Happen. And you can help us make it happen. Call us anytime during the show at 866-367-5827. Or you can send questions or comments right from our website at pluggedinland.org. Or you can email us questions and comments to questions@pluggedinland.org. And you can tweet us at @KVCR.
So we've been talking about Road Trip Nation, but I want to focus on Gateway at the RCC program. How much of your motivation came from a program where you got back on track? It was no longer independent study. You were now really in an immersive program. And how much was your defining your career?
Well, let's see. Motivation, I guess, came from the background of, from various backgrounds, I guess. My family, our struggles as a family. Also, how the background I have in particular sports, you know, how coaches are, you know, win at all costs type. And that's kind of how I transitioned that into academics. You know, now that I took a break from sports, all I really have is books now. I'm like, well, you know, I can be a champion here too, you know?
You took it pretty seriously. I saw a photo of a learning space.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, I sold my TV a while ago, so I was trying to earn some money to redo my room to make it more of a learning environment. I put in a couch. I took out my bed just to have it more of a... Oh, and now I'm also redoing the entire wall as a chalkboard, the entire, I think it's like 180 inches across, ceiling to floor, just a huge chalkboard that just, I can go from my desk, from my computer, or from a textbook and just throw out my ideas on the wall or work on some equations or something.
Saul, so I'm just gonna sanity check here.
Uh-huh.
You as a young man sold your television and put in a giant chalkboard.
Yeah.
Okay, most everybody else sells their desk to buy the TV.
Yeah.
So are we going to see you on A Beautiful Mind, sequel, you know,
maybe,
winning
hopefully.
The Nobel laureate?
Hopefully. That'd be awesome.
Jill, I want to talk a moment about student success. Mm-hmm. You ran surveys when they enter, mm-hmm. and then you also checked the surveys when they leave, and you're able to find some pretty amazing mm-hmm. changes over time. What are some of the struggles people had, and how does it change sure. as they're in the program?
Well, when students enter the program within the first 2 weeks, and all Gateway to Colleges do this, we ask students what their barriers were that they faced coming out of high school, which they just left or left not too long ago, but what were the things that got in their way? And it's not only the kind of academic and then outside of school challenges, but it's the number of them, the number of students that indicated five or more major barriers or challenge is huge. At least half of our students reported that. So there's multiple barriers. That
five or more faced by the same student.
Yes.
No one might be terminal in their high school career, but the combination of all five just overwhelms.
I think some of them are overwhelming in themselves. Most typically a new student will say, and overwhelmingly they do say over the years, nobody cared. I had problems with my peers. I had problems with teachers. I had problems with administrators. I didn't feel safe. There's some disclosure about drug or alcohol use. I'm having issues with the family. I need to work. But the first set that I indicated, the academic issues, the issues in the school were huge. What we find with the satisfaction survey that students take after being in the program for at least a year is a lot of those site-based and those school-based issues begin to recede, and dramatically so. I think there's more agency as students grow older.
More agency as in more...
They're taking the responsibility. People didn't get along with me, or people were doing things to me, or I had trouble with, you know, and rather than saying, well, I think it's demonstrating the extent that students are growing up through our program and also taking responsibility. And if there are issues out there, it's because I had a big role in there. But also what we see is some of the outside barriers begin to, if they don't recede, some of them also rise in terms of, I need to work more, I'm having issues with my family, I have a childcare issue. So I'm having problems juggling my adult responsibilities. So it's, I think we trade sometimes one set of issues for another when we cross the threshold from youth to adulthood. But a lot of those school-based and site-based issues definitely begin to recede.
And yet your students succeed.
Yes.
There's a statistic in your survey. How many students pass their college classes?
It depends on the term. I know in the intersessions we have at least an 80% pass rate. Usually during the long terms, it can bounce from 60 to about 78%. So it's pretty high. Generally, students need to get their foot in, you know, get pace themselves during the first term, and then they pick up the steam. It's like a typical freshman going to college experience. But our students, we prepare them well. Sometimes they just need to remember to practice the skills and the habits of being a good student that they practiced the first term that they were with
us.
The
national average seemed to point out that the pass rate overall, between 70 and 80%, is actually comparable to the college-bound freshmen that already graduated high school. And sometimes your pass rate exceeds theirs.
Sometimes. And sometimes we slip. It just depends on year to year. I won't say that we're always on the mark, but we do look at the data. And if our students aren't doing well in those college classes or in our charter school classes, we look at that and try and really look at the data and find out why. We meet with students, we ask them, and try and do it better and are informed by their story and the data.
Okay, we have a couple of emails. Okay. It's easy to email us on the pluggedinland.org site, so we certainly get them. The first one is an excellent question from Emily of Riverside. She writes, how is the experience at Gateway to College different from a continuation school?
Have you been to a continuation school? Do you want to take
I've had friends go to continuation schools.
What's your perception?
What do they tell you?
Well, from what I hear, it's very, very, it's a lot of busy work from what I hear. That it's not very challenging. You're just in and out. The textbooks, compared to the textbooks we have at a college, are just seem like, you know, a child could do them, you know.
What I understand you're telling me really in that case is, in order to help that student graduate, they simply lower the bar.
Mm-hmm.
And so hopefully with just a minor amount of motivation, that student can jump that bar and get that diploma.
Yeah.
And that's very different, I take it, from Gateway.
Oh yeah, Gateway, you have to, you know, climb over and under and, you know, any bar, you know, that's placed in front of you, usually over, just because it's so difficult, you know, but it's not impossible.
I'd like to weigh in because I've been an alternative education instructor, and some of the programs are very strong. They're academically very tough. They serve large numbers of students, and they oftentimes they need to create a format to get students completing. And I think that the focus really is on high school completion. what is very unique about Gateway is on a college campus, and it's not just about high school completion. It's called Gateway to College. It is Gateway to College. It's looking at students who are struggling, who've struggled, and not only looking at let's complete school, but let's look at your next steps. Who do you want to be? And let's prepare you and get you engaged in college now.
So really, you're taking students that probably or very likely would not have even graduated high school, and you're not focused on getting them through high school. You're focused on getting them all the way through the college experience, at least to an associate's.
And that's really part of the mission of those of us who are part of the Early College High School Initiative is we're reaching out and providing an early college experience to students who are low income, whose students are at risk, who traditionally are less likely to graduate from high school and much less likely to enter and complete college.
Do either of you know an Adrian from Riverside?
No.
Okay, well, you got a shout out. Adrian from Riverside says, I just want to say that Gateway to College is an amazing program, all caps. The instructors are the best.
Wow. I know several Adrians, yeah. So thank you, Adrian.
And then question from Emily Riverside. This is the same person that asked the last question. Saul or Jill, what is your most memorable moment at Gateway?
Ooh. Mine would be transitioning from just plain high school classes at Gateway to being able to actually, you know, bump heads and with actual college students, you know, people ranging from 18 to 50. You know, that was just, it was just a very, very scary, but also just was like that rite of passage, like you earned it, you know, here you go, you know, we allow you to, you know, pursue your goals.
And Jill, what is, say, the most gratifying moment you've had as the administrator of this program?
I think what gratifies me, and I have had several moments, and maybe I'm sort of backtracking from the question, is this is a transformational program, and it's amazing to see transformations in some students the day they came in and then the day they get their high school diploma. And sometimes I can think of a couple students that are unrecognizable because the transformation, it began internally, and then it began externally. We see that. We run two-thirds male, and oftentimes the most remarkable transformations, especially externally, are men. They come in as boys, and they exit as young men. Many of our women grow up, too. But I think, in my mind, I see some of the big changes internally and physically that our students come out of the program with as they become full-time college students post-Gateway.
Jill, I want to ask you one more question. It's emailed from us. Question from Lenny. What would make you turn down a student's request to join the program?
I think it wouldn't be a matter of not joining the program, but maybe you're not prepared right now. And I think that that's where a student wouldn't immediately be enrolled. We see students that might want to do the program, but they might be not their idea. It could be a parent's idea and the student really hasn't bought in. Oftentimes students really do need to have some good foundational skills. And again, if you're not at least reading at an eighth grade level and have eighth grade or level skills.
And I just want to clarify, yeah. Eighth grade reading is not simplistic reading.
It's not, but it's the minimum that we really need to work with in order to get students ready to begin college courses in another term. So that's really the biggest deal breaker also if a student is just sort of outside the age range. And sometimes they're on track and they love this program, but there are other programs for them if they're on track.
Thank you so much. Jill, I appreciate your being here, and Saul, I'd like to thank our guests, Jill Marks, Brittany Lopez, and Saul Baron, for discussing the Gateway to College program at Riverside City College. Next week, we'll examine another innovative back-to-school support program, Riverside's own Comeback Kids. I'm Roger Bowman. Thank you for watching Plugged Inland.